Good morning. Welcome to St. John's this morning, our final Sunday in Advent, as we prepare our hearts, looking to our Savior, for when the Lord comes near, he lifts up the humble, those of us who have been broken down and torn down, not only by the stresses of this life, but by God's law itself. He reminds us that he comes to lift us up and exalt us to his side in heaven. We follow the order of service of the Word today, printed out in your worship folder as well as projected on the screen. We sing our opening hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. It's an old hymn, but it is a new melody, so you might want to open up to your hymnals for this one. It's a fairly simple melody. I think we'll get it pretty easily, but it is a new melody. So we begin by singing, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve him as his dear children, but we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you, and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin, and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Come. Take away the burden of our sins and make us ready for the celebration of your birth, that we may receive you in joy and serve you always. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our first scripture lesson is from Micah chapter 5, verses 2 through 5, where the prophet Micah promises the coming Savior, where the Savior will be born in Bethlehem, and gives us an idea of what that Savior will do. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, from you will go out the one who will be the ruler for me in Israel. His goings forth are from the beginning, from the days of eternity. Therefore the Lord will give them up, until the time when the woman who is in labor bears a child. Then the remaining survivors from his brothers will return to the people of Israel. He will stand and shepherd with the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord, his God. They will dwell securely, for at that time he will be great to the ends of the earth. This one will be their peace. This is the word of the Lord. We join in singing Psalm 85. It's on the screen as well as in the front of the hymnal. The refrain is new, but the verses are familiar verses from the old hymnal. Our second lesson is from Hebrews chapter 10, beginning at verse 5, where the writer to the Hebrews shows the Christ as the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. Therefore, when he entered the world, Christ said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but you prepared a body for me. You were not pleased with burnt offerings and sin offerings. Then I said, 'Here I am. I have come to do your will, God.' In the scroll of the book, it is written about me." First, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings that were offered according to the law, both burnt offerings and sin offerings, you did not desire, and you were not pleased with them." Then he said, "Here I am. I have come to do your will." He does away with the first in order to establish the second. By this will, we have been sanctified once and for all through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. We read the lighting of the Advent candles. We light four Advent candles remembering Jesus, the Son of God and Mary's and Son of Mary. He came to share our humanity.
We remember
Jesus. We hear his call to give him a place in our hearts. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest.
Through your word and spirit, may our souls be blessed.
We rise for the reading of the gospel. The gospel for this fourth Sunday in Advent, which a portion of it will also serve as the sermon text, is Luke chapter 1, verses 39 through 55. In those days, Mary got up and hurried to the hill country, to a town of Judah. She entered the home of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. Just as Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. She called out with a loud voice and said, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? In fact, just now, as soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who believed, because the promises spoken to her from the Lord will be fulfilled." Then Mary said, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God, my Savior, because he has looked with favor on the humble state of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, because the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown the strength with his arm. He has scattered those who were proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones. He has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, but the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the aid of his servant Israel, remembering his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever." This is the gospel of our Lord. Be seated for the hymn.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Savior, Jesus Christ. God's word for our meditation is a portion of our gospel text, the Song of Mary from Luke chapter 1. Your brothers and sisters in Christ. In the ancient world, it was not uncommon that neighboring peoples would compete to make for themselves the biggest god. They would cut down larger and larger trees, carve bigger and bigger statues. They would quarry larger and larger rocks. They would muster all of their engineering might and wisdom to build the largest temples, all with the aim of making their god greater than all the other ones. But of course, we recognize no statue, no building can make God any bigger. In fact, those gods, so-called gods, were nothing. They were in their minds. They were empty. They were idols. But that practice is not limited to the ancients. It is something we still do today. Today, society, however, builds up idols with unrealistic expectations, with heaps of praise, with undue trust and adoration. People are taught to believe in themselves, to make themselves more important and greater than they actually are, all with the practical effect that we are still making gods, trying to make them bigger than everyone else's. And the net result is that as we make ourselves and our idols larger and larger, God becomes smaller and smaller. We're familiar with the words of John the Baptist. As he pointed to the Savior, he said, rather simply, Jesus must become greater, and I must become less. This morning, Mary quite literally says, my soul magnifies the Lord. My soul proclaims the greatness of God. My soul makes God bigger. What does that mean? From that word, we get the name of Mary's song. We call it the Magnificat. That's the Latin word that begins the song, magnifies the Lord. So why is God so big? Why should we make him bigger? Why should our worship, our lives, our praise, why should we proclaim him as one who is greater than all the others? What makes him different than the rest? What makes him worthy of Mary's praise and ours? As is often the case, the best praise that we can give God is to simply proclaim what he's done, to speak about who he is. And so this morning, as we ask the question, looking at Mary's song, how big is your God? We find there that he is big enough to care for humble servants like you and me. And he is big enough to carry out mighty deeds as well. What was so impressive about Mary? In the end, really, nothing. Yes, there are praiseworthy things about Mary, sure, just as there often are about any individual. But what was so special about Mary that she should be called the mother of our Lord? That she should bear the Savior in her womb? For that? Nothing. Nothing but the grace of God. She saw herself as just another young Jewish woman, pledged to be married to Joseph, but not yet. She knew she was far from a saint. She knew that she was not worthy of God. She knew she was not holy or deserving of special honor or praise. In fact, in her song, she highlights the humble state of your servant. Just as God's law ought to bring each one of us to that same place. We aren't here today to proclaim our greatness. We don't come to church to swell ourselves up and realize our full potential. We come to the Lord's house in part to humble ourselves before him, to realize our unworthiness, to realize that the very essence of our relationship with God is one that is entirely on Him and not on us. Because we don't deserve anything He has to give to us. She even says in her song, "All nations will call me blessed, blessed." We can twist that around. We can look at that and see Mary as someone special, as someone greater, but think about what that truly means. She's blessed. Blessed means you're given something by someone else. Not deserving, but receiving a gift of grace. The Mighty One has done great things for her. Holy is His name, not hers. Though innocent of adultery or fornication, or whatever else the world would have accused Mary of, as this young woman is now expecting a child, she is not innocent in the eyes of God, not on her own, not without the Savior that she bears in her womb. Yet God saw fit to show grace and favor to her. We remember the angel's greeting to Mary. "Greetings, you who are highly favored." Highly favored. The word there is graced. You who are graced by God. You who are given undeserved love from God. Why did she rejoice in the Lord and call Him great? Because He was mindful of her lowly estate. Yes, she was praising the Lord because He had seen fit to show His grace to her, to allow her to bear the Savior. But most importantly, it was because that God had allowed her to bear the Savior. Her Savior. Your Savior. He's given her what she needs. Rescue from her sin. That's what He's come to do. The very traits that might make someone a renowned scholar, praised in the academic world, might also be the very same traits that make someone a very poor kindergarten teacher. After all, what does a kindergarten teacher need to do? They need to bring themselves down to the level of those little children and recognize all the things they don't know. To speak to them in a way that even sometimes complex things can be made simple and understandable. To recognize all the things that they maybe can't do yet and to help them. To come down with them. To lead them through as they learn new things. You see how marvelous it is that our God, who is so great, who fills the heavens and the earth, who knows all things, who can speak in ways that we would never, ever understand, recognizes our humble state, recognizes the position not just of Mary, but of each one of us, and comes down to us and says, "I will save you on your level." That your salvation will not come once you've memorized all of Scripture, once you've written a treatise on all of the attributes of God, once you have done more good deeds than you can ever possibly count, then I will save you. No, He says, "I will come to you. I will give you my Holy Spirit, perhaps in a way that you don't even understand. Perhaps before you ever even understand that He's there working." He does that in baptism. He does that as we hear His word and sometimes are completely ignorant of the work that He's doing in our hearts, but He's there and He's doing it. And all of that is embodied in the Son of God, who was born in the flesh just like you and I, who came to endure all the temptations that you and I face, who came to bear all of the punishment for sin that you and I have earned. He doesn't solve our problem from up there. He comes and solves our problem right by our side. A kindergarten teacher who is able to relate to little children and help them, we would call great. It's a great teacher. So is our God, who is great enough to help us in our humble state. Not only does he know Mary's condition, he knows ours. And he is able to help us in our need. How often don't we underestimate the problems that we're facing? We think it's not so bad. We think maybe we can solve them ourselves. Somebody sees a fire starting, a burning building. They want to help. They run in to help, but they're not trained and they're not prepared. And soon they need rescuing too. But our Lord, who knew Mary's humble state as well as ours, comes with great mercy and love, but also great power, and can help us in our need. He joins us in our race. And that's how Mary found herself in the state that she was in, a virgin, pledged to be married, yet was with child. The mother of Elizabeth's Lord, the mother of our Lord, in her womb. What a great contradiction. That God is great because God is humbled. He was big because he chose to confine himself to the smallest of beings in the womb of Mary. That's not the picture we normally have of being great or big or powerful. Many might picture God in an ivory tower issuing commands down on the world, aloof and separate from us. But God's greatness is seen in how low he becomes. How good a swimmer are you? I'm not a great swimmer. Never really got past beginners. If you throw me off the dock or throw me off the boat, I can stay afloat for a while, hopefully long enough to get back to something solid. But if I had a child with me that was also struggling, or another adult who was maybe unconscious, we would both be in trouble. I don't think I could do it. I don't have those skills. I don't have that power, that strength to rescue someone else. That person would be lost, and so would I. How much more important when dealing not with water and waves, but dealing with sin and death, that we have a God who is so big, he can lift up the humble and helpless servants. Mary, like most Israelites, could easily list off the great works of the Lord. She could look back on the history of the Old Testament, on stories that were told to her from when she was a child, and recount them over and over. Many of them centered on the deliverance of Israel from Egypt. They could speak about the plagues and the blood on the door frames and the angel of death passing over. They could speak about the great pillar of cloud that led them through the wilderness. They could remember I'm sure she as a child wondered what it would have been like to walk through the Red Sea with walls of water on both sides, wondering what that must have been like and marveling and perhaps being filled with chills even as she remembers that water crashing down on the armies of Pharaoh. She remembered the judgment of the flood, the destruction rained down on Sodom and Gomorrah. She knew how big her God was. But his mighty deeds are more than just mere judgments. They were deeds of love for his people. Even those acts of judgment done in love for the people of God. Wiping out the sin on the earth with the flood, but preserving that message of the gospel through Noah and his family so that it wouldn't be snuffed out. Removing temptation from God's people that had infiltrated the nation. This is the same God who is working a mighty work within the womb of Mary. She was not a naive little girl who didn't know where babies came from. She knew that there was no earthly explanation for what had happened. She knew it had to come from the Lord, from his miraculous power. And every one of God's mighty deeds centers around his promises. More specifically, his promise. The promise of salvation, the promise of his son. There's a recurring Hollywood plot line. We've seen it again and again. There is a usually rich, successful, powerful individual. Maybe he's a politician, maybe he's a rich businessman, but perhaps his relationship with his child isn't so good. So he makes a promise. Don't worry, I'll be there for Christmas. Don't worry, I'll be there for your birthday, Johnny. But of course, what happens? He doesn't make it. He doesn't keep the promise. Something gets in the way. How good a father is that? Sure, he may have other redeeming qualities. I'm presenting a pretty sparse picture here. But the point is this, that what matters in our relationship with God is looking at his promises. What makes God great is that God keeps his promises. Whether he does it in a humble and simple way or whether he does it with mighty deeds, and indeed, at times in Scripture, that's how he had to do it. He had to do mighty deeds. He had to roll back the sun in the sky. He had to perform great miracles. He had to wipe people out, knock down city walls in order to carry out his promises for his people. He is able to do mighty things in order to keep his promises to you. The Lord's greatness can be seen in his mighty deeds, not just because they're impressive, not just because they draw our attention, but because they fulfill his promises to us. And now, so that's what Mary says in her song. When he says that he has shown this strength with his arm, he has scattered those who are proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He's come to the aid of his servant Israel, remembering his mercy, remembering the promises that he's made as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and his offspring forever. And so now you see that baby in Mary's womb is not just the next step, but the fulfillment. Yes, there was more that would happen, but it would happen because of and through Jesus. The fulfillment of God's promise to send a Savior. So draw near to him. When you're traveling and the mountains are in the distance and you're driving closer and closer and closer, what happens? The mountains get bigger. Maybe you're driving to Chicago. You see the big buildings. You see the tower on the horizon. And as you get closer, you get more and more glimpses, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. God is great. No amount of praises or offerings or deeds make him any greater. But he's not always great in our hearts and in our minds and in our lives. Draw near to him. Draw near to his word. Draw near to his sacrament. Draw near to him, to his cradle, his manger, this Christmas, and you will find a God who is greater than you could ever imagine. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join to confess the Christian faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We bring forward our offering. Our humble offerings now we bring to you, dear Jesus, Savior King. Accept them, small as they may be, and by your Spirit help us see whatever work needs yet be done, so others may learn that heaven is one, is work which each of us must do, and what's done for others is done for you. Amen. O Heavenly Father, we give you humble and joyful thanks for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for the salvation you have provided for all people in him. With contrite hearts, we turn to you, O God. We acknowledge our transgressions and confess that we have failed to do the good that we ought to have done, and that we have done the evil which we ought not to have done. Stir us to a renewed sense of our sin and depravity, and awaken us to our need for daily repentance. Come, forgive us and renew us. We pray for the wounded in spirit, for the sick, for the distressed in heart, that you would shine on them with your healing power. For all strangers, all travelers, and all who are away from home in any service or calling, we ask you to accompany them with light and joy. For the aged, the dying, and those who mourn, be gracious and give them the perfect peace of your holy child, Jesus. Finally, grant that our hearts may be a fit dwelling place for your Son, and that we may know the joy of his presence, the blessing of following in his steps, and the glory of that crown which he has prepared for all who are his through faith. In his name we pray, and we also join to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated for the next hymn.
Thank you.
O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Once again, pray for God's blessing on our worship today, on the word we have heard, that we might continue to be prepared to see our humble state, but rejoice in the greatness of our God. Take note of the announcements that are in your bulletin. A couple of highlights, unique schedule things this week. Some of you are probably are already aware that just due to a number of both COVID cases and contacts and things in our school, the Board of Ed did decide to end school after school on Friday, so they don't have school this upcoming week. That also means there won't be a children's service prepared for Christmas Eve. So on Christmas Eve, we will still have services at 4 and 6, just the same service twice here in the sanctuary. So you're invited to come for that. Christmas Day, 8:30 at Jehovah, 10 o'clock here at St. John's. And then on Sunday, just being the day after Christmas, we're only going to have one service that day. At 9 o'clock, one service, 9 o'clock next Sunday. May God bless us and be with us this wonderful week. Fill us with joy at the birth of our Savior Jesus. And keep us safe, whether we're traveling or others are traveling, to be with us. May God be with you till we come to his house to worship him again.